हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू करियर कंपास। दिस दीपन घाटालिया, योर ट्यूटर फॉर यूकेटेक्स एंड एसबीएल पेपर। आई होप दैट यू हैव ऑलरेडी चेक्ड आउट अवर यूकेटेक्स ईबुक, व्हिच इज अकॉर्डिंग टू माय ओपिनियन इट्स वर्ल्ड्स मोस्ट कन्वीनियंट ईबुक। इफ यू ज्वाइन अवर लाइव और रिकॉर्डेड ACCA यूकेटेक्स बैच, देन यू विल गेट योर हार्ड कॉपी ऑफ अवर मटेरियल फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट एंड वंस अगेन विदाउट एनी डिलीवरी चार्ज। फॉर मोर इन्फॉर्मेशन स्टूडेंट्स, फील फ्री टू कॉन्टेक्ट मी पर्सनली। Yes, students, let's start with the third chapter, which is the property income, students. Now, what does it mean by property income? It's nothing but the rental income that you receive on whatever property that you are having. So, it's basically kind of rental income only. Now, the important rule over here is that, students, that if your annual rental income is less than 150,000 pounds, then you have to follow the cash basis of accounting. Now, I think that I don't need to explain what does it mean by cash basis of accounting. So, you can see on the screen, students, you will have one pro forma where you can see easily that rent will only and only become taxable when you actually receive that rent. So it's a very simple cash basis of the accounting, students, concept have been followed. But if your annual rent will be more than 150,000 pound, then you compulsorily have to follow the accrual basis of the accounting. Now, students, let's start with the another concept, which is the next concept. It's a finance cost once. Now, the finance cost was previously in the previous Finance Act, which was the Finance Act 19. It was difficult treatment at that time. But now in the Finance Act 20, they have made a little bit the easier treatment for you guys. Now, if you are having the residential property, students, then you cannot claim the finance cost deduction from your property income pro forma. Now, that doesn't mean that you will never ever get the deduction of the finance cost if you are having residential property. Now, the HMRC is saying that you cannot claim that finance cost deduction from property income pro forma, but they will going to give you the 20% tax benefit for whatever finance cost you have incurred from your directly income tax liability. That means whatever pro forma that we have learned in the last chapter, students, along with the marriage allowance, another deduction you can claim from your income tax liability, and that is the finance cost of residential property. So basically, the finance cost deduction is available, but not from property income pro forma. It's available directly at the time of income tax liability calculation. So I hope, students, you got the idea. Now, if we talk about the non-residential property or the furnished holiday letting, if you are having any of these things and if you are paying finance cost for any of these property, then you don't need to worry. You can claim your finance cost from property income pro forma. Now, basically, as they are allowing you to deduct your finance cost over here from your property income pro forma, you can get 20, 40 or 45% tax benefit out of this finance cost. But if you see the above treatment, students, for the residential property over there, they have fixed that you can only get the tax benefit of 20%. Just like the marriage allowance over here, whatever finance cost you incur, they will going to give you the deduction at the rate of 20% only. Okay, so but still, students, if you are having query, feel free to ask me. Now let's come to the next concept, which is the capital expenditure. Now it's a very easy concept, students. Capital expenditure deduction is available because if we are following the cash basis, then there is no distinction between the capital expenditure or the revenue expenditure, so we don't need to worry. But there are exceptions where you cannot deduct the capital expenditure. There are three capital expenditures which are not allowed. The first one is the car, the second one is the residential property capital expenditure, and the third one is the land and building. Now, the cars and the residential building capital expenditure is not a major concern for us because, once we already know that there is a separate treatment available for the cars, and there is also a separate option available, there is a separate treatment available for the residential property capital expenditure. Right, so don't worry, we will come to that part also. But here you can see on the screen that here are the three exceptions where you cannot claim directly the capital expenditure deduction. Now let's come to the next topic, which is the car, students. If you purchase your car, then as I told you, you cannot claim the capital expenditure deduction, but that doesn't mean that you cannot claim any other deductions from the car. No, students, there are two options available if you are having your own car, okay, and that car if you are using for the properties or to manage these properties, then the first deduction you can claim, and that is the capital allowance, which means nothing but the depreciation. You can claim the depreciation on your car and you can claim that deduction. Please remember, they are not allowing to claim your capital cost of the car, but they will allow you the depreciation kind of the deduction. Okay, that is the first option. If you don't want to claim your capital allowance, then the second option is to claim the approved mileage allowance deduction. Now, I hope that you know already what does it mean by approved mileage allowance. But if you don't know, then also don't worry. The approved mileage allowance concept will be there in the next chapter, which is employment income chapter. So we will learn in detail that what exactly is the approved mileage allowance. Okay, but right now just understand that there are two options available related to the car's deduction instruments. But please remember over here that none of the options are going to give you the capital deductions. Now let's come to the next concept, which is the replacement relief. Now students, as per my opinion, this is a very easy kind of the concept. It's nothing but the students, we know that the residential property people can claim this relief. And if the residential property people, if they are selling the old asset, now what kind of the asset they can sell, students? The fridge, refrigerator, AC, TV, furniture, these kind of the assets they can sell. And on whatever disposal proceeds they have received, out of that they can purchase the new assets also. If you think that there is any kind of replacement is there in the question, then only you can claim replacement relief over here. So there are two conditions are there. First of all is the residential property has to be there, and the second one is there has to be the replacement of the asset. If in the question, if you don't find any replacement of the asset, then you cannot claim replacement relief. Replacement relief is not given on buying the new asset. The replacement relief is given on disposal of old asset and then buying the new asset. So I hope students you got the idea. Now there are students of qualifying assets also which can be claimed, or which on which you can claim your replacement relief. There are four qualifying assets you can see on the screen: the movable furniture, the furnishings, household items and kitchenware items. But please remember, the fixtures are not allowed as in replacement relief. Now, important thing over here is that, sir, what will be the amount of the relief? Now, the amount is not like, you cannot directly decide. It's not the cost of your new item, students. No, it's not the cost of new item you can claim as a replacement relief. No, you have to adjust the cost of your new item with the any kind of the disposal proceed you receive from your old items. So you can see on the screen, there is a clear cut proforma I have given, students, for your reference, which you can understand, which you can remember for the examination purpose. And if you apply that proforma, students, then you can easily decide your amount, that what should be your replacement relief amount. Okay, but students, the replacement relief do have lots of other stuff also which are important in the practical life. But I think that for the fundamental level taxation, this much knowledge is enough. But still, if you want to learn more about the replacement relief, I have given the replacement relief link. I have written the whole blog, and in the description you will find the link of the replacement relief, students. You can check it out. Now let's come to the next concept, which is the rent a room relief. Now students, there are two options in the rent a room relief also. Option one is the normal treatment, and option two is without any kind of the deduction of actual expenditure, you can just claim the fixed deduction of £7,500. But if you opt for option two, students, then forget about your actual expenditure. Now, as per my opinion, students, for the fundamental level taxation, students, this concept is the important one. They can ask you this question in the examination, in the MCQs also. So please remember this amount, and please remember this both the options. Now let's come to the next concept, which is the property business loss. Now, property business loss, if you are having, then in that situation, students, the first priority should be to set off your property losses against the current year property income from other properties. If you are having 5 properties, if you have incurred the loss from 1 or 2 properties, then don't worry, there are other 3 to 4 properties are there from where you have got your profit. So set off right now instantly from the other properties profit. If you cannot, then the second option is nothing but to carry forward for the future profit indefinitely. So now let's come to the next concept, which is the furnished holiday letting. Now, furnished holiday letting is nothing but the kind of hotels kind of the concept is there. The hotel business, resort business is usually fall for this FHL concept. But students, here are some conditions given if you want to qualify for FHL. So it's a given in the screen, students. I would recommend you to pause this video and read the all the conditions given over here, and then after only you should move forward. So I hope that you have checked out all the conditions perfectly, students, and these conditions can be asked in the examination as in theory also, so please remember that. But now, why any hotel business, or why should any property business should opt for FHL business or FHL concept? The simple thing is that, students, if you qualify for FHL, students, you can claim capital allowance for your assets, you can claim the BPR, you can claim the CGT's rollover relief also, you can claim for CGT's gift relief or business asset disposal relief or other kind of the relief are also available. Students, if you like gets qualified for the FHL, then you can claim your finance cost fully 100% from your property income, and lots of benefits you can see on the screens are available if you gets qualified for FHL. Then after, let's come to the next concept, which is the premium on grant of a short lease. Now, students, if you have given the asset on the short lease, then on the that particular short lease, students, you first of all get your lease payment. That means the monthly or quarterly lease payment you will going to get from the lessee. But now whatever regular lease payment that you will going to get, that will be the normal rental income for you. So that rental income, normal lease payment that you receive, students, will be treated normally as a rental income. But whatever the premium element that you get on entering into the contract with the lessee for 30 years, 40 years, 45 years lease period, that premium is a kind of extraordinary or extra payment that you have received. So that premium is having a specific different kinds of the rules given by the HMRC. Now HMRC is saying that whatever premium that you receive, the whole premium amount will not become taxable. There is a small element of the premium will only become taxable. Now how to decide that how much premium will be the taxable one? There is a formula given over here, students, and there is one whole example over here. You can see that if your premium is 100,000 pound, then and if your lease is just 40 years lease you have entered, then in that case your taxable premium is just 22,000 pound. You can see. So I hope, students, you got the idea. But for any kind of the query, students, feel free to ask. Here we are done with this chapter. Thank you, guys. See you. Bye.